Hi, my name is Dr. Brian Curtis. I'm one of the paleontologists here at Fossil Crates, and today we're here to talk about snacks. No, not the kind of snacks you eat, popcorn, M&Ms, and the like. No, we're talking about Saurophaganax, the largest Morrison Formation, that's late Jurassic, Western North America dinosaur yet discovered that was a carnivore. This theropod was unbelievably gigantic. Now, I came in this biased because I grew up with Torvosaurus, I studied the Torvosaurus material, and so I spent a lot of time thinking about Torvosaurus. This is the Torvosaurus hand claw. It's mighty, it's massive. It makes this Allosaurus hand claw look positively svelte in comparison. And then I got my hands on this. Look at the size difference. This thing is massive. There's a giant Allosaurus claw out there that's for sale, and it is much smaller than this, though it is as wide. This is a gigantic beast. So I thought to myself, well, let's go look into Saurophaganax much deeper. So I went to the literature, and surprisingly, there's precious little on it. It was named in 1941 by Stovall, and he put it in a popular magazine, and he laid out a picture of its hind limbs all together, which was completely staged over 350 miles away from the original quarry. I thought that was kind of funny, and no one knew until fairly recently. This animal was clearly gigantic. There's a femur, which is huge. It's probably the largest, longest, thickest femur to come out of the Morrison Formation in the late Jurassic of Western North America. Maybe the Jurassic anywhere. So I got to thinking, okay, it's a giant Allosaurus. It was originally thought to be an Allosaurus. The only character that Ray used, Stovall, to use to separate it was size. And size is a terrible character to use as a paleontologist. Why? Because when you use size, how do you know if you find a small version of the big animal? You need to have a character on the bone. And Stovall didn't have one, but he knew it was very close to Allosaurus. Enter 1995, Dr. Daniel Cherry, an Allosaurus specialist, went and looked at the Saurophaganax material very carefully. And after a great effort, he discovered one unique character that separates it from Allosaurus that's not size, and that's a parasagittal lamina. So what's a parasagittal lamina? Para means alongside or near, and it's running right alongside the neural spine and the presaic apophyses. Basically, it's these features here. And Allosaurus doesn't have those features, which means we now have a character. If you find a bone, even a smaller Saurophaganax should have these characters on it. He also looked at the chevrons and noticed that the chevrons, these are bones underneath the tail and all these dinosaurs, and they're very different than Allosaurus. Allosaurus has your normal chevron. It looks like a Y, it's chevron shaped. Simple, easy peasy. Saurophaganax also has Y-shaped chevrons up front, but when you get into the middle of the tail, they turn into these meat chopper, meat cleaver chevrons. Interestingly, thanks to convergent evolution, Tyrannosaurs have these meat cleaver chevrons. What are they doing with the tail that's different than Allosaurus? I don't know, but I can tell you that the vertebrae of Saurophaganax are giant. In fact, the largest Allosaurus material is 25% smaller than the Saurophaganax. Now, Saurophaganax gives us some problems though. It's not all easy. We have at least three giant individuals from the quarry, maybe more. We have a smaller individual from the quarry, all based on the presence of the same toe bone being there multiple times. But we also have another challenge. This material was collected during the Great Depression, and it was done by WPA, the Works Powers Administration people. These were farmers and ranch hands. They had zero experience collecting dinosaurs or preparing fossils. They blew them out of the ground with gunpowder. They hacked down till they saw the spongy interior bone, which they thought was bone. Unfortunately, the bone and the matrix were very similar colored, and so they would chisel away the matrix and take this bone skin, if you will, the bones, the exterior features, right off the bones. Disappointing, it's unfortunate, but that's what happened. And then the collection's been moved no less than 10 times, which has led to further loss, damage of the material. So someone really needs to go in there and do a really deep dive on these elements, because the elements we do have are spectacularly giant. I did a bone-by-bone comparison with Torvosaurus where I could compare vertebra to vertebra, and limb bone to limb bone. And in nearly every case, Saurophaganax came out with a longer, wider, or taller element of this of equivalent size. That's very strange to me because in the literature, everyone writes about how Torvosaurus is this megalosaurid, which it is, and it's a heavy, massive theropod. But we have no femur of Torvosaurus to do a direct comparison to the beautiful femur of Saurophaganax. The Torvosaurus cranial material seems to be as big or bigger, and the vertebrae in the neck and back are larger than the Saurophaganax, which would give it a heavier body, but the tail of Saurophaganax dwarfs that of Torvosaurus. When you look at the femur of Saurophaganax, it's bowed. Look at this picture here, you can see an outline. Now I compared this femur to that of Acrocanthosaurus, an early Cretaceous supergiant theropod, and Tyrannosaurus rex, the king of them all. Plus, I mixed in the largest Allosaurus for good measure. And you can see clearly that there's a difference in shape to the Saurophaganax femur that's not present on Allosaurus, which I think is pretty cool. One other item of note, I have a cast of the Saurophaganax femur, and when I measured it, it was roughly 2% less than the measurements that Dan Shuri came up with on his. And doing this research, I found that persons in Curry in 2016 say they measured a cast of the holotype of Tyrannosaurus rex. And their numbers are approximately 2% less than the holotype material that Osborne in 1906 wrote about Tyrannosaurus rex. Dr. Matthew Wadle also published a blog post where he talked about measuring Dystylosaurus, or the former, the holotype of Dystylosaurus, just now part of Supersaurus, but a giant dorsal vertebra. And when he measured the cast, he got numbers. And then when he measured the original material, to his surprise, the original was about 2% larger, 1.6 in some ways and upwards of 3 in others. So what this tells me is all of you folks, especially the researchers out there that are using casts for your work, just know that casts are a skosh bit smaller than the original material. If you use 2% and you're working on a good sized bone, I think you'll be all right. So I'm gonna show you the fossil crates Allosaurus versus the Saurophaganax. No comparison. The fossil crates Torvosaurus versus Saurophaganax. Ridiculous how big Saurophaganax is. And for good times, the megaraptorid claw that we have out of Argentina. It's the second longest megaraptorid claw known. Longer, but narrower, tinier. Saurophaganax, big winner. And then for fun, the T-Rex hand claw. Hilarious. So how big was Saurophaganax? No one knows. I have in my backyard two skeletons of Saurophaganax right now. They're casts, and they're giant. They make Allosaurus look tiny, but they're composites. There's very few known articulated Saurophaganax elements, a couple limb bones that are fused together, and that's it. So we don't know. We don't even know how many vertebrae it has, but we do know that it is 25% longer than an Allosaurus, and so this would put it in the 40 to 45 foot range, just using ballpark math. Weight-wise, I don't know how much it weighs. There's so many nuances that go into discerning weight, but I can say that it's heavier than any Allosaurus that's known. And I would say, based on what I've seen, that Torvosaurus is not this giant, robust individual in comparison. But I'm gonna leave the actual, those analyses to the biomechanical engineer, paleontologists, and the paleoartists, because they often do a heck of a great job looking at bone-by-bone comparison. So this was Dr. Brian Curtis talking to you about Snax, aka Saurophaganax maximus. One last thing I should say, it was originally called Saurophagus, lizard eater. However, it was later discovered that Saurophagus was already in use for a bird that eats lizards. So the name itself has been changed, and in 1995, Dan Cherry changed it to Saurophaganax, which the ending of ax means lord of the lizard eaters. I thought that was a pretty nice twist. Well, thank you kindly. Hope you enjoyed this. Adios.